This video contains elements that are not suitable for children under the age of 14. Viewer discretion is advised. Hey guys, Sean Faye Wolf of Diamond Axe Studios here. This video is long as shit, so let's not waste any time and get right into it. Y'all know the drill by now. My patrons suggested and voted on songs they wanted me to talk about, and the top 10 most popular picks got selected for me to talk about in this video. Furthermore, we've got nearly 60 songs that my top supporters on Patreon have personally requested for me to talk about as well, meaning that, yeah, pull out the popcorn, y'all. We're gonna be here for a while. For real, though, I can't thank you all enough for your support. My goal is to make content for you guys full-time, and your support is helping that dream become ever closer to a reality. We'll get to the real shilling later, though. For now, let's get right into the video. We're going to be taking a look at the top 10 songs in the general vote in just a few minutes, so for now, let's start off by taking a look at some of the songs that my top patrons have requested. Undertale has been a game on my 2 playlist for several years now, but even as someone with no real familiarity with the game itself, I've heard its soundtrack bouncing around quite a bit. Obviously, Megalovania is the one that gets all the main attention, but I feel like the main theme to the game doesn't deserve to be overlooked. Apparently, Toby Fox is a completely self-taught musician who composed the entire soundtrack for Undertale by himself with FL Studio, and the main theme is by far the one that underwent the most changes during development. I have to say, you can definitely hear the homebrew element in Fox's music. The themes have a certain rigidity and even stiffness to their structure, particularly evident in Megalovania, as well as the battle theme Fox composed for Pokemon Sword and Shield. That said, you can definitely tell that Undertale's main theme is a track that has a lot of work put into it, with a lot of dancing and interplaying melodies that really capture the sense of emotional journey and discovery which I understand Undertale to be about. Fox started his career making Earthbound ROM hacks, and you can definitely tell, because this sounds like an Earthbound track tinged with a unique element of hopefulness that makes it very endearing. And now to add another genre to the list of discoveries I've made on this show as we take a look at Snail's House, pioneer of a subgenre referred to as Kawaii Future Bass. For those who don't know, Future Bass is a style of EDM focused around capturing the swell and percolation of dubstep without the harshness or heaviness, pioneered by acts like Flume and popularized in the mainstream by the Chainsmokers in 2016. Kawaii Future Bass is a Japan-based subculture that aims to take these same principles and to make them sound cuter and more dreamlike, often while incorporating elements from Japanese pop culture like chiptunes and anime samples. Snail's House basically invented the genre single-handedly in 2015, and has continued to push it ever since then, with a couple viral successes boasting his profile in the meantime. Imaginary Express isn't really one of them, not even cracking a million views at the time of this recording, but it's still a pretty definitive example of his sound, even if it is a bit slicker and more streamlined, which I suppose is fitting for a song called Imaginary Express. This is kind of like Space Age Love Song by Flock of Seagulls, in that when you hear a song with this title, this is the best possible version of what you'd want it to sound like, and I think it's definitely worth giving a listen.
Double back when you got it made, 30 racks of weed, no fat in the collard greens. Off top is me, no cap, I don't bottle days.
I'm gonna go into more detail about this later in the video, but typically when listening to music for this series, I only just listen to the song as a standalone entity backed up by some research. And that's particularly unfortunate here, because East by Earl Sweatshirt is the exact type of song that would probably kill within the context of a larger project, but I don't really get a ton from by itself. The entire thing is essentially an extended rant that's intentionally smothering and overwhelming to reflect on his fuzzy mental state as he rambles on about his dependency on alcohol to cope with personal tragedy. Definitely a neat concept for a song, but not a particularly pleasant listening experience as a standalone entity. I feel like I'd enjoy this a lot more if it had some setup or payoff. If you know anything about Casey Hill, it's probably that she was a backup dancer for Kanye West, who signed her to his label after hearing one song from her, and then basically only promoted that one song and then completely ignored everything else she did until she had enough of his negligence and left the label in 2019. This song, Shades of Blue, is not that one song he promoted, but rather an album cut from the first EP she released afterwards. I listened to that first single, Experience, and while I personally don't like it as much as this one, I unfortunately do see why it was pushed so hard while this one was left on the side. Experience is a song that perfectly bridges the gap between the post-Lord soundscape of 2014 and the more experimental bass-heavy sounds that were bubbling up and would take over the scene by 2016. Whereas Shades of Blue is ethereal, haunting, grandiose dream pop that definitely fits more to my taste, but was maybe just a bit too ahead of its time for 2015. If this were released today, I could definitely see the Phoebe Bridgers crowd getting into this, with potentially even some crossover into the mainstream chillwave audience if it was promoted right. Regardless of success, though, it's clear that Casey Hill is an exceptionally talented artist, and I really hope that her big break is somewhere in the future. Now this here is an offering from Machine Girl, an American production duo who named themselves after a famous Japanese action gore film about a girl whose hand gets cut off by a ninja and replaced with a machine gun. Because, you know, Japan. That said, you wouldn't really get a sense of that influence just looking at the song, because this is actually a very interesting instrumental piece from a genre called breakcore, which essentially pushes the fundamentals of drum and bass to the extreme, emphasizing high frenetic tempos, clattering percussion, and heavy use of samples and instrumental loops. This song never really settles into any one key, sort of just staying in this weird atonal middle ground the entire time. But it goes so fast and has so much energy that it winds up drawing you into its own bizarre hyperactive atmosphere. Interestingly enough, this song's requester said that they have severe ADHD, and this is a song they use to calm themselves down and refocus whenever things get too overwhelming, and that their point of requesting it was really to spread the word about it to help anyone else listening who might have similar struggles. As bizarre as it might seem, yeah, there is something oddly calming about this song in spite of how manic it is, and I can definitely see the appeal.
Heard the bass ride out like an ancient maiden call. I can't take it, y'all. I can feel the city breathing, chest heaving against the flesh of the evening.
There's some part of me that feels like music as an art form will never truly surpass underground conscious hip-hop from the 90s, and this collaboration between hip-hop duo Blackstar with guest vocals from Common really does live up to that standard. Blackstar never really made a break for the big time, despite being label mates with both Common and Eminem at some point, but I unfortunately can't say I'm really surprised. I doubt you could have gotten this 6-minute heart-wrenching screed about every systemic problem these guys have ever faced in their entire lives onto the airwaves at a time when the hardest names on the radio were Puff Daddy and Will fucking Smith. That said, for those who were willing to give this a shot, they got an eloquent, poetic, and deeply moving anthem about struggling to breathe under the weight of a world that seems to be against them at every single turn. This requester says it's one of their favorite hip-hop songs of all time, and I can definitely see why. This is some high-grade shit right here.
Which one of you niggas think you really got them guts to walk up to his house, knock on his door, let him fill the book, shot some by 12 gauge?
It's completely understandable that so many people these days write off 3-6 Mafia, considering their awful sellout phase in the 2000s, as well as all the embarrassing shit that Juicy J's been getting up to over the past decade. But believe it or not, these guys once upon a time were not just legit, but outright pioneers of a genre called horrorcore, which utilizes dark, abrasive soundscapes and focuses on uncomfortable, transgressive subject matter. The most well-known example of this subgenre is Stand by Eminem, but the scene had a huge underground boom in the late 90s, with 3-6 Mafia's debut album being a primary example of this, touching on themes of ritualism, Satanism, and, in the case of this song, graphic violence. Even by hip-hop standards, the violence described on this song is pretty next level, underscored by Juicy J's unsettling, smothering production work and the menacing, blown-out, pitch-shifted vocals of the hook. It's probably the most normal song on the album, and yet it's so cold and dark that I really don't have much of a concrete opinion on it. If you thought that Jeffrey Dahmer line from Juicy J's verse on Dark Horse was out of character for him, no. Turns out that was actually him toning it down.
I'm not afraid to see the bottom.
Here we go again. Another grab bag review, another indie act with less YouTube subscribers than me. As you may have gleaned, this time I asked those submitting if they had anything they wanted to tell me about this song, and in this case, the requester simply responded with, "It's really good," and yeah, this is nice. I don't know if I'd go as far as to call it really good, but then again, I fully admit that my taste in indie music has been pretty warped by a full decade of over-commercialization. Not to say this sounds like a commercial, because it doesn't, but an indie act really has to do something noteworthy to get my attention. And to be brutally honest, I liked listening to this, but I don't really see myself returning to it in the future. The most notable thing about this is the title line, "I'm not afraid to see the bottom, 'cause I will," which is a line that I can definitely see justifying the entire song song for a few people all by itself. Here's my final verdict. I actually do highly recommend this song, but specifically the live version I'm playing right now from Atlantic Records Studios. The single version of this song sounds like yet another piece of by-the-numbers indie music, but between the extra harmonizations and more lively instrumental in the live version, it winds up sounding like a really good Tame Impala song, and if there's any version I'm going to be returning to, it's that one. We're getting on the wrong, my love. Where do you get me drift away? Walking on the Hudson, singing you my love song. Amy MacDonald is a name you probably don't recognize. She's an indie folk star who was a pretty big name in Scotland in the early 2000s and late 2010s, and this song, The Hudson, was a hit in 2020, being her first top 20 song in 8 years, and yeah, I can see why. It's pretty fantastic. I can sense a bit of influence from American country music in here, but this is clearly mostly a by-the-numbers indie folk tune, and a damn good one. MacDonald has a very expressive voice that definitely reminds me of something, though I can't put a finger on what. The closest I could get was Elle King pitched down an octave, but that's not quite right. And obviously being a UK folk singer with country influences, that kind of reminds me of KT Tunstall, but that's not exactly right either. Yeah, well, you get the idea. It's really engaging. This expressiveness takes the subject matter, which is about this woman reflecting nostalgically on a love that fell apart, and endows it with a sense of real romanticism. She's clearly sad about this lost love, but not upset by it. It's the bittersweet reflection of a woman at peace, and I'm really glad I know about it now. Out of all the songs I've listened to for the first time in this episode, this is the song by far that I've returned to the most of my free time since I started researching. So yeah, definitely check this one out. Sure how to review a vaporwave instrumental, I'm gonna be honest. Like, obviously I enjoy vaporwave, because really, who doesn't? It's one of the defining aesthetics of our generation for a reason, but without lyrics or a real human presence to tie into, I almost feel like reviewing the specifics would be a spoiler, because that's not how this type of music is supposed to be listened to. I mean, I could go into detail about the scientific principles behind why the human brain perceives a sunset to be a beautiful sight, but doesn't picking it apart and hyperanalyzing it like that kind of make it lose its magic? I know I've used this metaphor before, but I'm sorry, I really don't want to tell you anything else about this song besides this is something you definitely should listen to, and you should do it while wearing headphones late at night lying in bed in complete darkness. The top comment on the video reads, "This song celebrates the beauty of melancholy and alienation, a deeply intimate, deeply human feeling." And yeah, I don't think I can phrase it any better than that. This is some of the best vaporwave you're ever gonna hear. Go experience it. I'm modern Scott Walker. I'm a surprisingly smooth talker, and I'm invincible in these sunglasses. You know that the song is pretty solid when it's literally 10 minutes long, and yet you're surprised and kind of let down when it's over. Yet that's the case with Sunglasses, the most well-known song from British post-punk band Black Country New Road. Apparently there's this pub in London called The Windmill, and it's been the birthplace of a new wave of critically acclaimed post-punk, with this band being one of the leading figures in that scene, and I can certainly see why. The one part of it I thought was a bit iffy was this minute-long atonal break in the middle of it, which completely makes sense within the context of the song, but goes on for probably about 20 or 30 seconds longer than it needed to. But besides that, this is legitimately pretty great. The guitars have that same really nice, earthy texture you find in songs like Hanging by a Moment as a nice anchor, but then the song shoots off in a bunch of different directions as this guy starts ranting about the changing world, with each tangent bringing in a new melody with a different vibe and intensity to it. I reiterate, this song is 10 minutes long, but it doesn't feel like it at all. I was completely engaged the whole time, and for me to say that about an avant-garde post-punk song is probably the highest praise I could possibly give it. So, this is that JoJo's Bizarre Adventure y'all seem to like, huh? I'll be the first to admit, I'm not too much of an anime guy, and of those I have seen, JoJo is not one of them. That said, everyone goes on and on about what a life-changing experience it is, so maybe I'll have to check it out, especially if the music is anything like this. Before this, my only experience with JoJo's music was that To Be Continued meme, and I never really thought about that, but even that is a pretty slick and funky motif for what it is. I don't think I'd describe this track as funky per se, but it's definitely slick as hell, with some of the best horn accents I've I've heard in a hot minute. I obviously don't understand a single word coming out of this dude's mouth, but damn it is he hollering. This song is a hell of a ride. As you can tell by my incoherent ramblings, this 4.5 minute jam didn't really give me many specific thoughts, but it does make me want to go check out JoJo, so I guess it's doing its job. See this right here? This is the reason that I started this show. Tell me, where the fuck else am I going to be able to talk about a trap-flavored Tex-Mex comedy song telling the American Immigrants and Customs Enforcement Office to go fuck itself? I've never made a secret of the fact that I think ICE is a disgrace to the US government and definitely should be disbanded. And this dude, rambling on and switching on a dime between calling out the government for illegally detaining children and telling Donald Trump that he's going to steal Melania from him? Well, it captures something. Let's put it that way. One thing of note is that I always use Lyrics Genius to check a song. Lyrics because they're the most accurate, always taking the lyrics directly from official label releases of the lyrics. And yet for this song, they have question markers sprinkled all throughout in both the English and Spanish sections because they can't understand what the hell this guy is saying. Perfect. Absolutely perfect. When I googled happy song with four P's, the first result was this song, and the second result was Happy by Pharrell. That's very funny. Anyways, typically when one of you guys recommend a Japanese song to me, all the top comments are, fittingly enough, in Japanese. This time, all the top comments are English speakers memeing on it, and that is 100% understandable because, yeah, you have ears. You can hear this. And if you don't, either because it's muted or in fact you do not have ears, I am jealous of you. If I'm not sure how to review Vaporwave, I really don't know how to review music whose primary directive is to overload your senses. Here's what I'll say about Happy Song with 4 P's by So with 4 O's. It actually does have a pretty pleasant structure on top of all the overblown assault on your senses. I have no idea what the fuck this is, but I'm gonna hazard a guess that it's a pretty good take on whatever the hell it is, and it does in fact become more structured as it goes along, so... yeet, I suppose. We boxin' on them with our bling bling. Pinkie Pie's on deck and it's fashion bling. We hotties on a yachty, it's a special kind of party. When Evie made it clear that she intended to eventually get me to review the entire discography of My Little Pony, Friendship is Magic, one song at a time, I promised myself that I would try to be as objective as possible and not just mindlessly dismiss these songs because of the show they came from. That said, when I opened up the tab to listen to I'm on a Yacht by the Rainbooms featuring Spike, and within the first few seconds I had been assaulted by air horns, a music video where the ponies in human form not only rapping and doing hip-hop dances, but spitting out lines such as flossing on them with our bling bling, Pinkie Pie's on deck and it's fire she'll bring, immediately followed by the pink one using her grating helium voice to rap out, we hotties on the yachty, it's a special kind of party, we got Bodie Wodie's beach toadies. Okay, yep, I admit it. This song immediately reaches such a monumental level of cringe that it kind of comes full circle and you just kind of have to give yourself to it. That being said, my understanding was that this was a show that people watched for escapism, you know, as a means of forgetting the cruelty of the real world. So when I hear the line, lobster on a silver platter because the costs don't even matter, all expenses are paid, EG Crew has got it made, well... that was a choice, let's put it that way. And speaking of which, the time has finally come to take a look at the top 10 songs that all of the patrons voted on, so let's get straight into that. The fact that I'm talking about this song is disappointing, and I'm going to explain to you why. You see, usually when I'm reviewing a song I'm hearing for the first time on this show, my process is to listen to the song a few times, do some background research on the song and the artist, and then write my segment about it, making it very clear that these are all initial impressions. However, when I listened to Excess by Rina Sawayama for the first time, I only had one reaction. I need to listen to the rest of this album. I ended up listening to the rest of the singles off of Soyama's 2020 self-titled album, and they confirmed my suspicions that this woman is immensely talented and fascinating to discuss, and I liked literally everything else I heard from the album more than this one. Granted, that isn't because Excess is a bad song, it's a good song, but considering that everything else I heard from the album was a great song, I'm a bit miffed that this is the one that got voted in. The reason for this is that Rina Sawayama Self-Titled is clearly an incredible personal album inspired by the true soul of who she is, from her pansexuality to her Japanese-British identity to her clear love and passion for the pop music of the 2000s. This album sounds like literally every mainstream music genre of the 2000s decade all rolled into one, including TRL pop, R&B, nu metal, house, and tons of other shit. And they all have subject matter which very clearly pertains directly to some personal aspect of Rina's life and identity. It's a very personal project. Here's how she describes Excess in her own words. Quote, "We are all hypocrites because we are all capitalists, and it's a trap that I don't see us getting out of. I wanted to reflect the chaos of this post-truth, climate change-denying world and the metal guitar stabs that flare up like an underlying zit between the 2000s R&B beat that reminds you of a time when everything was all right." Unquote. I really don't think I can describe the song any better than that, because, yeah, it does exactly what it sets out to do by putting on full display the hypocrisy of a culture that recognizes the damage hypercapitalism does to the world while being too self-obsessed and defeatist to put up a meaningful fight against it. And it does have just about every iconic 2000s pop element you can think of, from shredding nu metal guitars to staccato guitar jumps to ominous string runs. It's an excellent version of what it's trying to be, and I can see why it's her most popular song, but within the context of the album, which doesn't exceptional job of mixing these iconic elements in just as effective ways while also catering to her emotional core, I can't help but feel a bit disconnected from it. I guess I'm not opposed to throwing a random anti-capitalist song into the middle of your otherwise coherent reflection on your life through the lens of family, race, and sexuality. And who knows, maybe it plays better in the context of the full album, but this is probably the last song I've heard from her that I'd actively return to. It's a high 7 out of 10 and an album full of high 9s, so yeah. Go listen to Rina Sawayama Self-Titled. There are some songs that you never really think about, never really focus on, and you can't really pinpoint the first time you heard them, or even really what you think about them, because they've just kind of always been there, always in the background. You know it, and you guess you like it. I mean, it's not like there's any reason to dislike it. Asking me what I think about Tom Sawyer by Rush is like asking me what I think about having brown eyes. Like, yeah, I guess I like it fine enough. It's just kind of a simple fact of my existence. And I gotta be real, I don't even really know why you're asking. I didn't recognize this song by name when I saw the suggestion, but I knew who Rush were, and I had a gut feeling I'd probably know which song it was when I heard it. And when listening to it, I was like, oh yeah, that one. So, yeah, that's both my relationship to this song and essentially my thoughts on it. It's apparently the most played Canadian rock track of the 80s on the radio, and that stands to reason, because this is 100% a song that I've just come to accept through cultural osmosis. I must have heard it over 100 times out in the wild at random points in my life, and never have I had any cognizant thoughts about it besides maybe a quick nod of my head. Now that I am paying attention, yeah, I'd say cool but an essential background music is a role that suits this song quite nicely. Content-wise, it's basically dressing up Tom Sawyer as a metaphor for the modern-day rock and roll drifter, just going wherever the wind takes him and not beholden to anyone or anything. A simple comparison, but an effective one that does hold your attention once you decide to give it. I was surprised to find out that this song came out in 1981, which seems simultaneously way too early and way too late for something like this, although that perception is probably warped because in my mind, mainstream rock from the pre-MTV 80s sounds like either Van Halen or Chicago with not much in between. Yes, I'm a plebeian, I'm aware. And I guess this one does do some neat things with its synth pattern. The tone he picked for that dancing hook is pretty harsh and grounding. I don't know, this song is pretty undeniably a rock classic, but it's not one that particularly merits much discussion in my mind. Hopefully my ramblings about it were enough to satiate you, though. Holy shit. this one takes me back. You gotta understand, 2016 was basically the first time that I became completely aware that music outside the pop charts existed, as I started really looking around and listening to alt-rock radio in my car and searching up new music on YouTube for the first time ever. Parallel to all this, I was simultaneously discovering that other people on YouTube besides Todd in the Shadows were doing this whole music discussion thing. First I found Buckley, then Ethan not long after that, and right around the time I saw Kumarai Fang doing it was when I figured that it might be worth giving this whole YouTube music discussion thing a shot myself. So here I was, putting together all these plans for my awesome new YouTube channel while simultaneously discovering this whole new community of YouTube music critics, all in the midst of one of the worst years for popular music in recent memory, and then, out of nowhere, the legendary gods of alt-rock decide to drop a new single for the first time in half a decade, and against all odds, it actually manages to chart. Dark Necessities basically ruled my life for a few months in 2016. I thought it was legitimately one of the greatest things to happen to music in years, and that it signified that America was finally getting its taste in music back after an onslaught of Meghan Trainor and the Chainsmokers. It's been 5 years since then, and I have grown several orders of magnitude better at both analyzing music and being self-aware, which is why my current summation of Dark Necessities by the Red Hot Chili Peppers is as follows. It's exactly what I would expect a new Red Hot Chili Peppers song to sound like in 2016, and that was all it needed to be. RHCP didn't need to reinvent the wheel with this album. They'd so thoroughly established themselves as alt-rock gods over the previous 25 years that they had no obligation to break any new ground. Their MO for this entire album was to just jam the hell out and do the same shit that got them famous, sharpened by their decades of experience while avoiding any degradation with age. Granted, the freshness of this song and the entire album is probably attributable to producer Danger Mouse, best known as the second half of Gnarls Barkley and the co-producer of Gorilla's biggest album. Needless to say, this guy knows his way around a funk riff, and Dark Necessities bounces and pops along with the best of RHCP's back catalog. Whoever we have to thank for how sweet this one turned out, we do, in fact, have someone to thank for this dark little jam. And speaking of thanking people, it's now time to thank my top patrons for their generous support by taking a look at some more of the songs that they've requested for me to talk about. Alright, time for me to pretend like I know anything about anime again. This here is the theme song to a show that ran from 2014 to 2020 called Is the Order a Rabbit? About a girl in a European country town in the Japanese countryside who goes looking for rabbits and winds up finding a secret boarding school instead. Because, you know, Japan. The only thing I can even vaguely relate this to is that one time I went to my college's anime club with the girl I liked and saw a few episodes of Princess Jellyfish. And I relate the two not because their theme songs sound particularly similar, but rather because they're basically the only shoujo anime I've really seen. Shoujo basically being anime marketed to teenage girls the same way shounen anime is marketed to teenage boys. Most of the anime themes recommended for this show so far have been for shounen series, and that's definitely clear because this one definitely seems much bouncier, happier, and sweeter. When I think of the word kawaii, this is basically the exact sound that pops into my head, and much like other kawaii things, I think it would probably be best for everyone if I took a live and let live approach to this type of content, because, yeah, this is a bit too cutesy for my taste. Insert you tell her that you've been a tongue. Okay, right off the bat, this is a song about cheating the devil, and they conveyed that fact by naming it after the Game Shark, a device to input cheat codes into game consoles in the 80s and 90s. That's fucking awesome, and this song? Also fucking awesome. I'll be honest, I liked XS fine enough, but in my opinion, if you're gonna write about a topic as dire as consumerism driving us towards extinction, you might as well go all out with it and completely envelop the listener with dire insanity, and Game Shark by Foxing is a great example of how this can be done. This song uses a lot of extremely colorful metaphors about being tempted by the devil and how the temptation can never really be avoided no matter how hard you try, and that's exactly what it sounds like, a swirling vortex of evil surrounding you from all sides and drawing you down a spiral of insanity. This song is cool as hell, and I certainly recommend giving it a shot to see how it clicked with you. I should have flown with someone else or gone by car. 'Cause United breaks guitars. Harkening back now to the glory days of 2009 YouTube, we've got United Breaks Guitars by Sons of Maxwell. I wasn't even paying attention to YouTube in 2009, and I still remember this song being an absolutely huge deal, and if you don't know why, well, the title United Breaks Guitars is quite literally what the song is about. It's a country song where this dude writes about his real-life experience of flying United Airlines and seeing his guitar case being carelessly tossed around on the tarmac, and when the expensive instrument came back broken, he chased them down for reparations for a year, eventually realizing that the only way he would be able to get their attention was to humiliate them with a song about the incident, which worked flawlessly, as within a month of the song's release, United stock had dropped 10% and cost the company $180 million. This is not only a classic viral video absolutely dripping with catharsis, but it's also a genuinely great country song with hooks for days and very slick, evocative, and eloquent lyricism. Goes to show the value of putting effort into your shitposts, I guess. Oh, by the way, when Fox News interviewed Carroll about the experience, they asked him why he shipped his guitar through the baggage if he was so worried about it being broken, which is quite possibly the single most Fox News thing I've ever heard in my life. Even if I don't always like what they come up with, I always have some degree of appreciation for bands who just do whatever the hell they want to all the time, genre be damned. And if you're a band named Polka Dot Cadaver, composed of members of another band called Dog Fashion Disco, yeah, I'm gonna go out on a limb and say your goal is to make awesome music and let the fans come to you, which is apparently working out quite nicely for them. This requester recommended this song to me because, quote, "You seem to appreciate music with big ideas a lot, and this song has a lot of ideas shoved into a short time." And yeah, this is fucking manic in the best way possible. My best attempt to describe it would be, imagine if Neil Cicerega had an alternative metal band, and then one day he went on a really bad trip and got it into his head that Jesus was actually a werewolf. I think that should give you a pretty good idea as to whether this is something you might like, so if you're enjoying what you're hearing, go search it out. I personally can't imagine a scenario in which I'd really want to return to this, but I can definitely see the audience for it.
I've got your jacket on my back and it hasn't lost your scent yet.
Well, this officially takes the title of most impossible to Google song that I've ever talked about, considering that there's also a song by J. Cole called Sunset, whereas the requested song by Cole called Sunsets doesn't even have 1,500 views on YouTube. I was able to find virtually no information about this one. I honestly don't even know if Cole is one person or if that's the name of the group. The only thing I do know is that whoever's behind it, they got talent, because this is really sweet. Basically, it's a song where a girl sings about being in a long-distance relationship and how everyone is telling her it's a bad idea, but she's out to prove the doubters wrong by making it work until her partner gets back. Not the most revolutionary idea in the world, but it's a very sweet one, and the relaxed, vibey synth atmosphere with the rolling guitar patterns make you feel like you're gazing out into the sunset. This was a nice find. I like it.
So come on, let me drink. Come on, let me drink.
I can't believe I'm about to say this, but this country-tinged song with a thudding 808 and trap influences? Pretty good sing-along. I really like it. Apparently, Guy Sebastian was the first winner of Australian Idol back in 2003, and he's been one of the biggest pop stars in Australia ever since then. This particular song from 2019 was not a hit, but damn it, I'm not sure why, because this song somehow manages to both slap and swing at the same time. I think the reason for that is its gospel influences. Sebastian did say this song in particular was influenced by his days growing up in a church choir, and taking that same high-tempo groove and applying it to a song about throwing one back after a long day of work and stress, hell yeah, I'm gonna sign off on this. I honestly think this could have been a hit stateside if it had any promotional avenues here, and hey, this dude has gone to Eurovision a few times. Stranger breakthroughs have happened. This is quite possibly the most moving double entendre I've ever heard in my entire life. This here is in fact not 100 Years by Five for Fighting, despite the incredibly similar vocals and melody, but rather Keep Yourself Warm by Frightened Rabbit. Best known for its appearance in the comedy drama spy show Chuck, a show which was apparently constantly on the verge of cancellation until fans wrote a petition to Subway asking them to cover the cost of the remaining seasons, and they actually did it. True story. I have to say, it doesn't surprise me at all that this was the soundtrack to a comedy drama show, because it's that rare song that's both legitimately moving and also kind of makes you smirk at the same time. Not only is the lead singer's falsetto both kind of overwrought but also really charming, but the lyrics are all about how this woman needs emotional intimacy because she won't be able to find all the love she needs in a hole with him, and that both means exactly what you think it does and exactly what you think it doesn't at the same time. You could legitimately play this at the end of an episode of either Dawson's Creek or South Park and it would be equally fitting, and I really admire when a song is able to match two polar opposite tones completely unironically. And I like 100 Years by Five for Fighting, so yeah, thumbs up from me.
Like, what's up, danger? Like, what's up, danger?
Considering that Ultra's last two picks were from Home Alone 2 and Disney's Oliver and Company, I suppose I shouldn't be surprised that his next pick is from another family movie, but, yeah, this is definitely a bit of a different direction, and I am totally here for it. I've gone on and on about how I think Spider-Verse is easily the best mainstream animated film to come out of the 2010s, and this is not only because of the stellar soundtrack, but because of how absolutely flawlessly it ties into the movie. The reason I hold Spider-Verse in such high regard is because literally every single piece of it was a deliberate choice done purely because the filmmakers believed it was the right artistic decision, which is extremely rare to see in mainstream cinema, and the music is just one piece of this beautiful puzzle. What's Up, Danger is the soundtrack to the centerpiece of the film, where Miles finally comes into his own as Spider-Man, and the marriage of visuals to the action are so flawlessly unparalleled that it would take a full video essay to go into detail about them. You want my review of this song? Find the biggest screen you can with the most powerful speakers possible and go watch Spider-Verse on them. That's my review. In the same way that Sunglasses didn't feel like it could possibly be 10 minutes long because of how engaging it was, I find it impossible to believe that McTriffe by Arca is barely over 2 minutes long because of the sheer amount of musical ideas crammed into this. Arca is a non-binary trans woman from Venezuela who has apparently collaborated with Sophie, FKA Twigs, and Kanye West. So yeah, you can tell that she isn't actually trying to pander to the mainstream here, but rather just bushwhacking her way through the cluttered soundscape of her mind in search of a musical vision, and oh, boy, had she found one. I'm not even sure what genre to call this, since I don't really have a comparison point. There's a lot of vocal pitch shifting, reversed samples, stutters and jumps, and on top of that, the whole thing's in Spanish, so while the lyrics are apparently about identity and accepting oneself, I have a feeling that I'd have a hard time focusing on them even if I did speak the language. I think this one is a bit too far off of my musical palette for me to really connect to it, but then again, at just over 2 minutes long, this also serves as a perfect bite-sized appetizer into Arca's world, so yeah, this is definitely a cool change of face for me, if nothing else.
Slip to the new black gold, there's a heartbeat under my skin. Search my electric soul.
I'm a sucker for bombastic cinematic anthem rock, and when you theme it around one of the greatest video game series of all time, yeah, I'd say that's something that'll get my eyebrows raised. I'll fully admit that I'm not familiar with Deus Ex, the series this song was written in tribute to. Me calling it one of the greatest just then was purely based on hearsay. I don't actually know the first thing about it. And the fact this song kicked so much ass in spite of me not knowing anything about it is a real testament to what an awesome composition this is. One-man band Miracle of Sound is on fire here, with a textured production of what he calls cyber rock, and what I call Linkin Park with a few of their harsher edges sanded down. That might seem like a diss, but it's really not. I actually think the smoother, more leveled out tones fit what he's going for really well, especially considering the lyrics are so sharp, crying out against the evils of the fossil fuel industry and rallying against this new black gold running through his veins. I can only assume this means he's singing from the point of view of an android or a cyborg or something, especially as the rest of the lyrics talk about finding humanity within the frame, and it's that type of detailed writing that still paints with broad strokes that makes this appealing to you even if you don't know the games. This is a banger. Definitely recommend it.
And I was running far away. Would I run off the wall someday? Nobody knows.
Man, TikTok is one hell of a drug, ain't it? Here we've got Runaway, a single from the Nordic art pop singer Aurora, which came out in 2015 but didn't hit the charts until early 2021 because... we'll take a wild guess as to why. Frankly, I'm not surprised this one got picked back up, considering that cute little bridge about running is ethereal and pretty, while still having a solid bass structure to sync those little freeze frames up to. Apparently, this was literally the song that inspired Billie Eilish to start making music, and yeah, that's pretty clear. I can hear a lot of Ocean Eyes in this, specifically in how it takes the same detached floating vocals and gives them a bit more of a traditional pop structure. The only thing I knew Aurora from before this was being the guest vocalist on Not Let It Go from Frozen 2, but considering this song's solid pedigree and how much indirect influence this has had on the current sound of popular music, I'd definitely be down to check out some more from her. Be sure to give me your suggestions.
And her friends want to help, but it's hard to tell her, hard to let her know that a man's possessive and aggressive.
Even as someone who doesn't follow British hip-hop at all, I still heard more than once in the wild that Psychodrama by Dave was one of the best albums of 2019. Considering what little I've heard from him through watching Mode's videos, I had ascertained that the guy made pretty by-the-numbers trap music, a lot of it not very good. Therefore, my natural assumption was that Psychodrama just had him switching up producers, getting some hot beats, and spitting out some fire. But I have to say, if Leslie is a good representation of what this album is, Well, let's just say that Psychodrama is a fitting name for the project. I mean, I don't know what I was expecting when I sat down to listen to this track, but it certainly wasn't an 11-minute spoken word story about a woman falling victim to an abusive relationship, laid masterfully over an understated instrumental that grows and swells with intensity over time as the tragedy of Leslie's faith in a bad man comes crashing down on top of her, and ending with a desperate plea from Dave to all those in abusive relationships, saying that he can't put himself in their shoes, but he's known too many victims to just stand by and say nothing. This is an absolutely excellent piece of hip-hop by any definition of the term, and the fact that this was the centerpiece of one of the UK's biggest albums of the past few years has absolutely floored me. I've been a Nintendo kid for pretty much my entire life, and while our family did have an Xbox, my brothers were really the only ones who used it. The one Xbox game I have significant memories of playing was, in fact, Halo 3, specifically The Forge, which allowed us to create our own custom maps and have intense PvP battles between teams of friends on the couch. I never played the campaign of the game, and honestly, the music never really stuck out to me, which is kind of amazing considering that I've absorbed a lot of Halo music over the years as background music of general gaming videos, and it's some of the highest grade work you'll find in the industry. This particular tracklist for the Mombasa Streets campaign of ODST is a perfect encapsulation of one of my favorite musical feelings, warm darkness. You know, when music conveys an atmosphere of foreboding, but still tinged with a touch of wonder that makes you want to push onwards into it. It definitely lives up to the highest pedigree of Halo music, and if ever I want something to listen to as I fall asleep at night, this will definitely be on my radar.
I finally lost control. I tore my tuck and roll.
Phantom of the Paradise is a 1974 comedy rock musical that apparently has a massive cult following, and one of its biggest draws is the eclectic soundtrack. This particular tune, Upholstery by the in-universe band The Beach Bums, is a pretty clear pastiche of the Beach Boys sound, with high whistling harmonizations and lyrics about cars and girls. Or more specifically, the upholstery within the car that the girl is sitting on. Yeah, I think that gives you a pretty decent idea of the type of movie this is. This song is most notable for its use of a split-screen tracking shot within the film, viewing a performance from two different angles at once as it eventually ends up getting shut down. I'm honestly not really sure what to say about the song itself. I mean, it sure is a Beach Boys pastiche, all right, no doubt about that, but I will say that it does look like a pretty interesting movie. I'll have to check it out someday.
Everybody in the world is actually me.
I'm a scary monster, I'm just so sick and twisted.
Oh, how does one describe I'm at the Beach Today by Drive 45? Well, imagine if Bill Wirtz wrote a song, got Scott the Waz to sing it, and then had Flying Kitty produce it. If that sounds like something that there is even the tiniest, most remote iota of a chance that you might find interesting, check this out. That's all I have to say about this. If you're looking for music that I have a bit more to say about, well...
Castaways, we are castaways. Ahoy there, ahoy.
I have to say, I really applaud your devotion to the gag, you guys. I mean, in the last Grab Bag Reviews, the number 7 pick was a TikTok song about life on a whaling ship, and now the number 7 pick is a TikTok song about emphatically not being on a whaling ship. Nice approach to continuity, I gotta say, I really appreciate it. Anyways, I could go on yet another long-winded rant about how much more fun and engaging TikTok has made the world of music, blurring the line between irony and sincerity to the point where I'm genuinely not sure whether the recent viral success of this song from the Backyardigans is a joke or not, and frankly, at this point, it doesn't really matter. But I'm not gonna do that, because I have something else I want to say. In the British number one hits video, I mentioned how genuinely excellent the musical score of Thomas the Tank Engine was, and how my obsession with that show growing up may have led directly to my obsession with music throughout my life. You may have thought I was joking or exaggerating when I said that, but no, I'm not kidding. I do not come from a musical family. My parents don't play instruments and don't listen to music outside of the radio on car rides. The majority of my musical exposure at a young age came from watching those VHS tapes. The fact fact that I can still remember the majority of the musical motifs to Thomas the Tank Engine, the Magic School Bus, and Little Bear to this day really goes to show that introducing a child to a rich, thoughtful musical tapestry from a young age really can have an impact on their growth and development. And so in that sense, I'm not surprised that all the kids who grew up with the Backyardigans are memeing it now, because this is yet another one of those shows that clearly put an exceptional amount of effort into the music. YouTuber Adam Neely has already made a fantastic video breaking down pretty much every aspect of this song in detail, so I highly suggest you go and watch that after this video is done. But in short, one of the primary goals of the Backyardigans was to introduce children to different styles of music and dance with every episode, and Nickelodeon was willing to shell out quite a lot of money to the show's composer to make sure this was done properly. Unlike the overly simplistic harmonic relationships you find in less thought-out TV scores, or hell, even in most mainstream pop music, Castaways is a faithful recreation of a traditional bossa nova song that uses some distinctly non-standard chord progressions to keep you on your toes, most notably resolving on the sixth note, which keeps the song from ever really reaching a natural conclusion, constantly keeping your attention so that these same non-standard chords can be used to emphasize the lyrics without fading into the background. Again, I really suggest you check out Adam Neely's video. It's a great watch and he goes really in depth, but the main point I want to make is that Castaways is a genuine classic bossa nova composition, with all the appeal inherent to the genre and no compromises due to the young age of its demographic. It's a genuinely beautiful piece of music, and I fully understand why so many people have seen fit to return to it. Gentlemen, welcome to the Mindfuck. So, whether intentionally or by coincidence, two of the songs selected for this list were alt-rock classic one-hit wonders from the last few years of the 90s that A, both were made in direct reaction to the alt-rock scene around them at the time, and B, are both considered to be among the best rock songs of the decade. The two songs ended up with the exact same number of votes, and since this is the one I like less, I decided to talk about it first and leave the best for last. Fifth, I suppose. That said, Flagpole City is still a lot of fun, with a huge locomotive sound and one of the most satisfying sing-along choruses of the decade. There have been many, many times in my life where I've thought, I'm not sick, but I'm not well to myself, and this is the song that popped into my head every time. That said, the most interesting thing about this song is the primary subject matter, because this song is, in essence, a comedy song. Well, okay, no, it's not a comedy song, but it is largely a joke. Basically, by the late 90s, the whole alt-rock scene had been around for so long, it had taken on such an ethos of bloated self-importance that from an outsider's perspective, it had become utterly laughable. And this song essentially takes that same ethos, but presents it through the lens of a raving neurotic lunatic who thinks he's speaking truth to power, but is really just rambling on about jerking off, random amputation, and the voices in his head taking a nap. As much as I hate to contradict Don McLean, I think the teens of the 90s were the real generation lost in space, in an age of sunshine and happiness with no real threats to worry about after the collapse of the USSR, with a brave new world of rapid economic and cultural growth that they had absolutely no idea what to do with. I found a YouTube comment about this song that reads, and I quote, "Flagpole City is the anthem of Generation X finally giving up on making a difference. After all this whining and complaining, they all put on neckties, caused the dot-com bubble, and went bankrupt on housing mortgages." That's obviously a reductive way to look at the entire situation, but it is a perfect way of looking at what this song is trying to capture. If the 90s were all about a frustrated generation coming to terms with its lack of identity, Flagpole City is the anthem for giving up on the search. Everything is stupid, nothing matters, maybe this entire search for meaning is just a lot of bullshit in my head, maybe I'm not sick, but I'm definitely not well. Of course, if you found that pill a bit difficult to swallow and you were instead looking for a different answer to the frustrations of being a 90s kid, well... you could just listen to this instead. If Flagpole City is smirking in disdain at how overwrought and smothered in irony the 90s had become, You Get What You Give is tying all the baggage the decade created to a bright red balloon, letting it go and watching it drift up into the bright, vibrant blue sky. This song might as well have been specifically engineered to kill the very concept of irony. It's so genuinely sincere, happy, and sonically uplifting that you expect it to be a parody, but No, when this guy says you've got the music in you, he's not patronizing or talking down to you. He's saying, fuck it, let everything go, embrace the dreamer's disease, run through the streets, cause problems for those who have it good without a care in the world, and just live your goddamn life. This song is the shut up and dance of the 90s, nothing but good vibes, wistful freedom, and embracing the beautiful, glorious messiness of being young and having no clue where you're going, but knowing that you're gonna make a lot of great memories along the way. Just like Shut Up and Dance, it's well earned its title as one of the best and most beloved pop songs of its era. When Steve Miller tells you to fly like an eagle, this is what doing that sounds like, embracing the sensation of being completely above it all by just refusing to engage with the world and its bullshit. In fact, the only time this song even references the real world is the bridge right before the outro, where Greg Alexander machine gun fires off a whole host of evils of the modern world, from predatory health insurance to bank fraud to the vapidity of celebrity culture. In context, it comes across as Alexander just vomiting out all the bullshit that he doesn't want to take with him on his flight, but he's gone on record saying this was just a test to see whether people would pay more attention to him calling out celebrities over him calling out the banks and Big Pharma. And sure enough, all the headlines about this song talked about nothing but Courtney Love and Marilyn Manson, with Manson straight up saying he'd bash Alexander's skull in if they ever met up. All that is just window dressing, though, because this song is essentially perfect. It takes all the right risks, giving it just enough of an edge while being so fundamentally strong at its core that its long runtime and slightly repetitive nature are actually a boon to it, since they let you stay in this beautiful world of sunshine and freedom for just a little bit longer. Absolute classic this one is, and I'm thrilled that more people are recognizing it for that. And now let's go on the hunt for some more classics by taking a look at some more of the top patron requests. Pretty sure by this point this series can veritably be called a musical museum, showcasing styles and genres from all over the world that I had never considered before, and here we have yet another example. I have to say, I've never listened to a 6-minute chamber song performed entirely in Irish before, or at least I'm pretty sure that's Irish, considering that The Gloaming is an Irish-American supergroup of some of the most widely acclaimed Gaelic folk musicians in the world. Lyrically, this song apparently speaks to some sort of spiritualism and reflection on music or resurrection. I'm really not sure, the only English translation I could find were pretty stilted, but as a non-native speaker, I can say that this is, at the very least, very pretty. Particularly with respect to lead singer Iarla O'Lionaird's voice, and yes, feel free to laugh your ass off at how badly I'm probably butchering that name. I'm not well-versed in general world music at the best of times, but I will know that in comparison to what little Celtic music I've picked up over time, this one is definitely quite structurally defined, and if you're looking for an austere, peaceful little something to calm yourself, this'll definitely do the trick. Through research, I found this song is apparently most well known for being the main menu theme for Forza Horizon 4, a game in a series that I have never played before. I would have thought that a low-key indie chill tune like this wouldn't be a great fit for a racing game, but apparently one of the game's primary features is being able to drive around an open-world Great Britain while the seasons change around you, making it somewhat of a zen experience. And now that I know that, yeah, I don't think I could have picked a better match for it. This track perfectly conveys the sensation of driving through beautiful, peaceful, natural scenery, with the highest tempo elements tangible but still muted enough to meld seamlessly into the fold. It's a really serene piece, and honestly, now I kinda wanna go play Forza. So yeah, once again, I have to say this song is definitely doing its job. You know what, I'll be damned if there's one other song that might manage to match A Moment Apart as the ideal theme for a relaxing driving game, it might be this one, because good lord is this song a vibe. This is a track from Toys, an album David Bowie planned to release in 2001, but got cancelled due to label disputes and only released as an unofficial leak 10 years later. Apparently Bowie considers this album to be some of his best work, and while I don't claim to be an expert on Bowie by any means, I'd say he might be onto something, because this is easily one of the best things I've ever heard from him. The entire thing is structured on this beautiful rolling piano played against this understated funk guitar, and as Bowie layers countless vocal runs on top of it, it ends up just transporting you to a new world of lighter-than-air serenity. The lyrics are pretty understated and blend into the background, but their theme of moving on and passing the torch provides a match made in heaven with the overall tone of the song. This requester pointed out that as a song written in the 60s, recorded in the early 2000s, and released in the 2010s, it has a trapped-in-time sort of feeling, and yeah, I think that's a good way of putting it. Truly top-tier stuff, this is. The only only things I really know about Poppy come from that old film theory episode dissecting the nature of her performative identity when she first gained traction back in 2016. And frankly, if I had to pick one phrase that accurately describes who I am as a general human, it would probably be the guy who knows about Poppy because film theory talked about her in 2016. I've heard a lot of buzz around her in the years since, but I haven't really followed any of it, and so now that I'm listening to this, I really hate to say it, but I think I was expecting a bit more. Okay, so this is a bubblegum-tinged new metal throwback about questioning whether she was a girl or not, and how she wishes society would stop putting people in boxes. So there's obviously the basis for a great, fascinating song here, but not only are the pop and new metal influences not anything particularly special, nor is her performance, but the extent to which she questions the validity of gender is just to ask, am I a girl, am I a boy, what does that even mean? And saying that she's glad she's not a boy because then she'd have to put on a brave face, never show vulnerability, and pay for the tab on dates. It's all just a bit basic and surface level is what I'm getting at. Obviously, as a straight dude, this wasn't meant for me, and if this speaks to you, I'm happy for you. I'm just saying that after talking about Sophie last time, my standards for pop songs addressing gender identity have been pushed into the stratosphere, and this one just isn't doing it for me personally. Maybe that directness hit harder back in 2018 when all this discourse was less mainstream than it is now, but yeah, this one didn't really get me to think or feel the same way Immaterial did. Sorry.
When I dance alone and the sun's beating down, blame it all.
One thing that Mode and I unfortunately had to cut out of our British number one hits video was that apparently the guy who made Budapest back in 2015 is one of the biggest musical superstars in the entire UK. I do quite like his big hit, Shotgun from 2018, but unfortunately this mid-level hit from 2014, Blame It On Me, nah, this one ain't for me. It's an example of that distinctly mid-2010s brand of radio-driven folk rock that you got from Philip Phillips, Mumford & Sons, and the Lumineers, where I'm sure the albums were good, but every big hit they had just had no real teeth to it and just kind of existed in the background, with the only thing distinct about Blame It On Me being that George Ezra sounds exactly like Halsey pitched 2 octaves lower. Besides that, the only thing that really sticks out to me about this song was why he wrote it. Apparently George Ezra wrote this when he was 18, when he realized that he had countless opportunities around him to play his music and do what he loved, and that those opportunities were only going to grow scarcer as he got older, and if he failed to capitalize on the amazing opportunities at his fingertips, he would only have himself to blame for it. And I just can't imagine what that's like.
Truth just hurts too much. Hey.
So it turns out the dude who voices Steven Universe is actually the same age I am, and when he's not busy singing ukulele songs about wanting to see his friends turn into kaijus, he's making deeply personal narrative-driven alt-rock EPs about the mental anguish of maturing into adulthood in Hollywood. So yeah, I learned something new today. If I had to guess what type of music this guy made in his free time, my first guess would not be Queen-inspired rock operas with songs that open and close by quoting Bible verses in Italian, but, you know, books and covers and whatnot. Zach Callison has clearly listened to a lot of theatrical prog rock in his day, and those influences give what otherwise might be a pretty by-the-numbers piece about feeling distant and disconnected due to the phantasmic reality of the film industry a real epic flair to it. This is really cool. Apparently this entire EP is a concept album with a cohesive narrative, and I'm definitely interested in checking it out now. This was a damn good first impression.
Guardo in alto tipo scalatori, quindi scusa mamma se sono sempre fuori, ma sono fuori di te.
I'm not gonna front, I've never paid even the slightest attention to Eurovision, largely because I don't really have that much interest in music competitions in general. The closest I've ever come was back in the day when I watched America's Got Talent with my family, but even that eventually stopped when the show devolved into a constant string of trite feel-goodisms and incessant tugs at the heartstrings. I know Eurovision is far more complicated than that, but I've still never paid it much thought, nor do most people I know, which is why it's been crazy to see the meteoric rise of this year's winners, Italian hard rock band Måneskin, who have been topping the charts worldwide with an array of singles, including their winner song, Ziti e Buoni. It seems to me that their success is largely based on the fact that they're the first new hard rock act to get this much worldwide attention in, you know, I don't know, 4 or 5 decades. I fully admit, I've been jamming out to Beggin' for several weeks now, largely because it sounds exactly like something that could have become huge in the late 70s, and Ziti e Buoni is the exact same thing. These guys aren't reinventing the wheel or anything close to it, but the mere fact that one of the biggest bands in the world right now is retreading the well-known tropes of classic hard rock and glam rock and doing it this faithfully, I mean, yeah, I get the hype.
Now today is tomorrow, and tomorrow today, and yesterday is weaving in and out.
If I say the name Cake, you probably won't recognize them as a band. If I say I want a girl with a short skirt and a long jacket, there's a significantly higher chance that you'll recognize it as a song these guys made. It's really nice to actually know about one of these mid-level alt-rock bands before they get requested, since I did in fact have short skirt, long jacket on my playlist way back in the day. This song, Comfort Eagle, is from the same album as that song, and while Short Skirt, Long Jacket was a series of slightly neurotic ramblings about a specific woman, Comfort Eagle is a series of slightly neurotic ramblings about... honestly, I have no fucking idea. It's literally just following this dude's random train of thought over a chugging metal guitar punctuated with a sitar and some Arabic melodies played on pan flute. The requester says they like this one because of its warm desert sound and... yeah, I guess I could see it. I mean, I personally wouldn't call these desert sounds as much as oil lotion zone from Sonic 2 sounds, but the instrumental does have a nice earthy texture to it, though not really a gritsy one like I'd expect in a desert-sounding tune. Yeah, this is a strange one, but I don't regret listening to it, and I'd say it's definitely worth checking out. I'm really surprised that I don't get more K-pop requests on this show, and I'm even more surprised that this is the first time I've heard anything substantial about Super M, especially considering that not only was this from one of the most commercially successful K-pop albums of 2020 in the US, but this is easily the best offering I've heard from any K-pop act to crossover so far. Granted, I'm not claiming that's a definitive statement, I'm certainly not well-versed in K-pop myself, but I feel like this is one of the most dynamic, interesting, and attention-grabbing songs I've personally heard from the genre. I feel like a large part of that is that the song has clear influences from hip-hop and dubstep, despite clearly being dance pop at its core. And unlike certain other K-pop acts I've heard, those influences don't seem particularly awkward or forced. It's a melting pot of styles rather than just a salad bowl. It's not particularly deep, just a song about stepping into town, conquering all foes, and being the best there is, but it has a lot of fairly wordy English segments that weave in and out of the Korean bits effortlessly. This isn't just a great K-pop song, it's a song that can create new K-pop fans.
Everybody knows that shit. I can be your Lindsay Lohan. I can be Madonna. I can be your Marilyn Monroe. I can be Rihanna.
The second that someone decided to make a fan cam featuring a bunch of different content creators from the YouTube music critic community, I knew it was only a matter of time before that song got requested for this show. So what do I think of it? Well, imagine if TikTok had a baby. And then imagine what that baby would sound like when it cried at night when its parents tried to sleep. Yeah, that about sums it up. My word on the street is that an important aspect to becoming an adult is acquiring a taste for freeform jazz, so I guess that must mean I'm turning into a boring old fogey, because this song, Heavenly Summer by Japanese brother-sister duo Orange Pico, pretty good. Granted, this isn't technically freeform jazz, it's a more generalized jazz fusion that takes distinctive influence from bossa nova. Even just the differences in sound between this live version and the official version tell me that these guys aren't particularly keen on producing a singular, clean, immaculate product, but rather just finding a vibe and riding it to wherever it takes them. This particular vibe they found is, well, it's a Heavenly Summer vibe. Very warm, pleasant, inessential, but still very sweet. Like so much of what I talk about on here, I personally don't have a ton to say about it, but I certainly see why it has an audience.
You can lift your head up to the sky, take a deeper breath and give it time.
I gotta be honest, I have no idea why this song was requested. I could find next to no information about either of these guys, and really the only notable thing about them is that they're signed with Monster Cat, the same label that Marshmallow came from, which, yeah, that about checks out. I mean, this is the exact kind of drum and bass-ish electronica I would expect to find in one of Marshmallow's old label mates, and the lyrics about growing tougher skin to face the world are there, I suppose. At the end of the audio upload, they say that they'll have new releases every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and that's exactly what this sounds like, just another weekly upload to a long, ongoing drum and bass playlist. Then again, this song does have 60 million views on YouTube, so it's clearly speaking to someone. Yeah, maybe I'm just missing something.
Bitch, you better praise God, or I'ma shoot, and that's on God. I ain't playing by my Lord and Savior, I'm on my job. If you ain't a Christian, I'ma stab you in the face.
If anyone ever asked me to define chaotic good for them, this song is now officially my go-to point of reference. Kenny Beats is a producer with a YouTube show where he invites rappers on to do freestyles, and when he had comedy rapper Zach Fox on, he said to Kenny, and I quote, "Make me a beat that sounds like RuneScape mixed with Jodeci mixed with Almond Milk mixed with domestic violence. Make me a pro-lifer beat. Make me a Bernie Bro beat. Make me a post-9/11 pre-death of Whitney Houston style beat." He then takes this beat and raps about, among other things, freeing Palestine, freeing TK, how sad it is that Betty White died, robbing strip clubs by walking around them with glue on his shoes, dipping his balls in Thousand Island dressing, and doing some extraordinarily inappropriate things with a bag of Doritos. Apparently both Kenny and Zach were exasperated that this song went viral on TikTok while stuff they actually put work into wasn't taking off, and when I tell my grandchildren what being alive at this moment in time was like, I think I'll just tell them that story and they'll get a general idea of what we were about.
Charlie Puth, I got so much swag,
woo! I got so much swag, woo! I'll be completely honest, when I got this request, my only real reaction was the jarring realization that it's been more than 3 years since I made my Worst Hit Songs of 2016 video and infected your minds with the glorious virus that is Charlie Puth's YouTube comedy career. And considering that I literally have 30 times as many subscribers as I did when I made that video, the overwhelming majority of you probably have not heard me talk about that. If you want a full rundown of Puth's Little Dicky era, I suggest you go and watch that video. And as for this one, if I can be completely honest, no sarcasm, no bullshit, this is probably my least favorite skit Puth has made. It's bad music, it's shitty lowest common denominator comedy, and there's virtually no reason to keep listening after the first 20 seconds. If you want to listen to a Charlie Puth song from that era, you know where to look.
Who threw this pickle at me?
Ow!
Who threw this pickle at me?
Excuse me?
Can't you see I'm trying to mack this bitch?
And on the subject of ridiculous shit posts that somehow led artists to mainstream careers...
I was gonna clean my room until I got high. I was gonna get up and find the broom, but then I got high.
What's going on, y'all? This is the Hungry Hustling American Dream, / African American Wet Dream, the Rock and Roll Gangster, the Kenny Red of Reefer Rap, the Don Juan a Dank, the Successful Failure, the Acceptable Reject. I get disrespect. I get disrespect. I get dissed. But with respect, OG Amsterdam, Afro, money-making, marijuana-smoking mother, M-A-N, you know what I'm saying? Right about now, my man Sean Fay Wolf, he wants to know how because I got high, I became so huge. First of all, everybody was high. When I wrote the song, you know, everybody talked about smoking on endo, sipping on ginger juice. They were saying it, but they wasn't really elaborating on the effects. I elaborated on the effects. And another thing that made it big was the anti-weed smokers thought it was an anti-song, and the pro-weed smokers thought it was a pro-song. So I was taking stoners' money and cops' money, like governor. Everybody liked that song, man. Hey, I just shut the fuck up and kept singing, brother. Hey, you know what I'm saying? And that song is huge because humanity on Earth can relate to that song, if not personally, vicariously through another person. And that's my hypothesis on why because I got high is so huge. How it changed my life? I used to be skinny, but then I got high. I used to be poor, but then I got high. I used to didn't have no women. But then I got la da 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 da.
You get a fast car. I want a ticket to anywhere. Maybe we make a deal. Maybe together we can get somewhere.
It's not very often you find a song that you can confidently say would have been a hit at pretty much any time in the past 60 years, but when I see that Fast Car by Tracy Chapman hit the top 10 in 1988, the year when the biggest names in music were INXS, Guns N' Roses, and Rick Astley, I can only think that, yeah, it makes sense. We've talked a lot in this video about the whole ethos of the 90s, how something felt imperceptibly off to those who were teenagers during that time, as they struggled to find out what their collective lot in life was, and despite coming out 2 years before the decade started, Fast Car by Tracy Chapman seems to tap into that exact same ethos. Then again, the part of the 90s that brought us Fight Club and American Beauty isn't the only comparison point for this song, since the whole sensation of wanting to get into a fast car and drive away from everything you know, strung along by the promise that whatever's waiting for you out there in the world has got to be more fulfilling than what you've got now. That's a pretty tried and true standard of pop music, a topic that's existed for basically as long as pop music itself has, with the most notable examples of it being Come On Eileen and Born to Run. There's just a certain universality to these concepts, because being a young adult is the only point in most people's lives where leaving everything behind and just bushwhacking your way through the world with no ties to anywhere is even feasible. And even as you get older and settle into your routines, there's always going to be that nagging voice in the back of your head asking you, what if? Honestly, that question, what if, is really the entire appeal of Fast Car as a song, as Tracy Chapman tells about how her mom left her dad to go chase adventure in the great wide somewhere, leaving her pinned down at home to take care of her useless dad, and now she's decided to take that leap outward into her mother's footsteps with nothing to her name but her partner's hand clenched in hers and the one fast car they have that will take them to their new future. This is the type of song that feels cliched in retrospect because so many other songs have tried to be it, but very few of them have ever managed to capture Chapman's voice in both writing and delivery, which can only be described as a huge sigh being let out as all of her ties are finally being cut. This is a song for the dreamers of the world, and I can't sing its praises highly enough. I'm sure that one of these days I'll understand the massive, raging hard-on that my fanbase seems to have for Paramore, but I'm sorry, I'm just not there yet. I think it was around the time where I saw a Twitter poll rank Still Into You as the single best hit song of the entire 2010s that I started to realize that I just wasn't on the same wavelength as everyone else, and probably never would be, because pretty much everything I've ever heard from Paramore can be accurately described as decent to very good, but not particularly special. Obviously, you're entitled to disagree with my opinion if you want to, but yeah, I'm still gonna call them pretty overrated. Still good, mind you, but definitely overrated. That said, Hayley Williams has always had a great voice and a commanding stage presence, and I'll always appreciate any alt-rock band with textured diverse instrumentals with a distinctly human touch, particularly when they're willing to go into so many different directions. I may not love Ain't It Fun, but I will admit that getting a top 10 hit led by a xylophone was pretty novel. Hard Time seems to be held up as Paramore's Runaway With Me, an unfair flop in the wake of prior commercial success that more people deserve to know about, and yeah, that description isn't wrong. I certainly don't think Hard Times lives up to the hype, while Runaway With Me absolutely does, but this is more like a blinding light situation. Just because I don't think it's the best thing ever doesn't mean I don't think it's a hell of a good piece. There's always going to be room for another funk-tinged new wave jam in the world, and a lyrical theme of being crushed and overwhelmed during the worst points in your life for juxtaposed against the bounciness of the instrumental, a classic pop music trope that never seems to grow old. I wish I had more to say about this song, but really, what you see is what you get with this one. This should have been the pop music radio staple of 2017, and I can only assume it flopped because its sound just didn't fit in with the zeitgeist of that awful gloom bomb of a year, even if its lyrics definitely did. So, yeah, I'm glad you guys love this so much. I at least understand why, and don't let a buzzkill asshole like me ever take that enjoyment away from you. And now, before we look at the top voted song for this season, we have one final round of top patron requests to get to. Let's do it. You know I wish that I had Jesse's girl. I have to be honest, I don't fully understand the mentality behind using your request for this show to have me talk about one of the biggest hit songs ever that I definitely am going to be talking about at some point in the future, but hey, if you want to get a jump on my opinion, I'll definitely respect that. But I'll tell you that, surprise surprise, I think Jesse's Girl by Rick Springfield has fully earned its title as one of the most beloved songs of the 80s. The most interesting thing about it to me really is that it came out in 1981, a year where pop songs were either everlasting classics or total disposable garbage, no in between. And frankly, a couple synth tones aside, there really isn't much that's distinctly early 80s about this song. The second you hear the words Jesse's Girl, and hear that first chorus that slams to a stop on the word that before creeping back in with understated subtlety, you've instantly got an unforgettable song on your hands. So I guess it's just natural that everyone knows this one. I feel like a universal truth would be broken if they didn't. There are some guys who never really got a big pop break, but still managed to find consistent success by just pumping out albums nonstop for decades on end while working as a producer behind the scenes. And one of the most notable of these unsung heroes of the pop world would be George Duke, who put out more than 30 albums between 1966 and his death in 2013, all of which touched on different flavors of jazz fusion depending on the zeitgeist of the time. This particular song, Reach Out, was released in 1983 and was actually one of his biggest hits on the R&B charts, and I can certainly see why, because this song is 7 pure minutes of jazzy post-disco goodness. Not much about it really prompts further discussion. There was a ton of music from this period that sounds exactly like this, but it's still a good sound, which I dare you to listen to without getting a huge smile on your face. And George Duke definitely deserves more attention than he gets, so yeah, check this one out. So this requester comes from a Romanian family and pointed out to me that this is the type of music that their cousins tend to play on blast, with the specific offering being from Ionica Minune, who's apparently one of the best accordion players in the world. Personally speaking, yeah, I will definitely concede that this is certainly technically impressive. I've had no idea that the accordion was even capable of producing sounds this busy and dexterous, but on the other hand, a song that shoves in this many notes in this short of a space without a ton of variation has a way of getting very old very quickly. And considering that this song is 12 minutes long, yeah, I was kind of ready to check out before the 3-minute mark. While the melodies and chord structure may change, the fact is that you could go to pretty much any 2 points in this piece and they'll sound very fundamentally similar. And when you compare this to something like Flight of the Bumblebee, which is equally chaotic but manages to pack in far more variation and dynamic intensity and tone into a quarter of that time, yeah, I can't really say this one is for me. Sorry.
Yeah, it's okay. I tie my hands up to a chair so I don't fall.
So this is the follow-up single to Pumped Up Kicks by Foster the People, which in my opinion was the first song to become a hit in the 2010s that could not have been a hit in the 2000s. And while their follow-up, Hell in a Beat, may not have charted on Billboard, it was actually the 5th most streamed song on Spotify that year, which was its first year of American availability, racking up more streams than Party Rock Anthem, Super Bass, and Moves Like Jagger. This is a song that I imagine a lot of people have nostalgia for, and even putting nostalgia aside, I definitely understand why so many people love this. It's got a lot of very quaint little characteristics of early 2010s production that you don't see too often anymore, notably some harsh, clashing synth tones that managed to still reach a really cool resolution, as well as generally weightier production that kind of fell out of favor as indie rock became more commercialized. Even as someone who wasn't a big indie rock snob back in the day, this is still managing to hit me right in the childhood, and even if you aren't nostalgic for this era, I have a feeling you're still really gonna like this one.
You got to hang with your lover. When you're undercovers, if you wanna get to it, just do it, don't do it halfway.
If you were to ask me what type of music I would expect Kevin Bacon and his brother to make in their free time, light funk would not have been my first guess, but hey, I guess you can't judge the star of Footloose by his covers, ha ha ha, but yeah, no, this is pretty nice. While it may not have the grandiose pedigree of someone like George Duke, this song nonetheless does remind me of Reach Out, because both of them seem, well, inessential is the wrong word, so let's go more like self-satisfied in a really relatable kind of way. Pumping out best-selling albums wasn't a primary goal for George Duke, and it obviously isn't a goal for Kevin and Michael Bacon. And because of that, what you wind up with is the purest form of music that's purely being played for its own sake. The Bacons aren't trying to innovate or make anything crazy or new with this song, they're just jamming out because they genuinely love making music, and because you know that commercial success isn't anything they're particularly concerned with, that gives the music this wonderfully laid-back, carefree affect that does kind of get its hooks into you. It's just a couple brothers doing what they love in their free time, and there's something kind of beautiful about that, really. Yes, 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 inject this directly into my soul. Holy shit, oh my good lord, all of my yes. I'm not even gonna try to be objective with this one. I didn't even play Sonic Adventure 2 growing up, but when 11-year-old me finally unlocked Sonic the Hedgehog in Super Smash Bros. Brawl after several months of playing Sonic Mega Collection, I fully expected to hear a bunch of the awesome Genesis chiptune music when I got to play Sonic Stage Green Hill Zone. What I got instead was this awesome hard rock banger about charging your way through life, overcoming all in your path, and becoming the hero you always knew you were meant to be. And to 11-year-old me, this was a mind-blowing direction that I didn't even know video game music was capable of going in. And you bet your ass this was the background music to every single custom stage I made in Brawl. Even though I've never played the game it came from, Crush 40's Live and Learn still managed to be a definitional piece of my childhood. I will love it unconditionally until the end of time, and the only real critical analysis I'm gonna give it is that I really give Sega a lot of credit that in an era where ugly Nickelback-flavored butt rock was the ethos of the day, they decided to soundtrack their cutting-edge modern Sonic game with a far more universal breed of hard rock glam rock fusion that certainly does feel like the early 2000s in hindsight, but is still not anywhere near as dated as it could have been. I'm genuinely surprised that the main vote didn't include at least one DMX song, but I am very glad that I now have a chance to talk about what was technically his biggest hit during his lifetime, even if it was a posse cut with LOX and a hook by Lil' Kim. The LOX is best known these days for a couple late 90s remixes for Puff Daddy and Mariah Carey, as well as launching the solo careers of members Style P and Jadakiss, but for one glorious moment, they had their proudest moment in the sun in 1998 with this all-time hip-hop classic where they reflect on the way the world goes around as they vie for power and influence within it. This is as definitive as 90s East Coast hip-hop gets, built on a slick string sample that drives the whole thing forward, and with each member bringing forth their own unique brand of energy that's impossible to turn away from until the song is over. DMX in particular stands out as a more aggressive firebrand than the others, and while he never needed help with getting recognition in his day, this is definitely a solid sampler of his appeal. Clarence Clarity is probably best known these days for being the lead producer for Rina Sawayama, who we discussed at the beginning of this video, and while Rina managed to take a bunch of very avant-garde left-of-the-dial ideas and make them a bit more streamlined and digestible for a mainstream audience, Clarence's solo work makes no such concessions, instead being one of the most singularly unique takes on electroclash that I've ever heard, specifically by incorporating certain elements of funk and mainstream pop while still dialing everything up to 11. This is another one of those songs that is stuffed to the brim with sound, and yet it still managed to have the cadence of a more nostalgic type of pop song, so, okay, let's put it this way. Imagine if Death Grips produced an Aaliyah song from 2002. That's really the best way I can describe this, because I have no other point of reference for what this sounds like. I personally think this was a musical tour de force that deserves several orders of magnitude more attention, but even if you don't end up liking it, I don't think you're gonna regret checking it out.
Touch my watch, where you wanna get dead? Yo, run up, you might get shift. Yo, run up the right and lift. I don't know.
There are very few more tried and true ways to make a classic hip-hop song than to find the hottest beat you can and go fast and hard as fuck over it while shit-talking your rivals. And it turns out that tactic rings true no matter where you came from, because this British posse cut is one of the coolest I've heard in quite some time. I'm typically not a fan of songs where beefs make up most of the lyrics, since I don't particularly enjoy having to do homework when listening to my music, but when the beats are this hot and the burns you're dishing out are so generally effective, the specifics don't really matter. I first heard about this one when the Mode Reviews called it his favorite British hit of 2020, so I'm gonna suggest you go check out his list for analysis from someone more intimately familiar. The most I've got to add to this is that few hit songs from anywhere recently make my head bang as hard as this one, and I certainly think Drill Song Stateside could benefit from taking inspiration from this.
That's what the mask is. That's what the point of the mask is.
Is it too harsh for me to say this song is the worst possible end result of what happens when a suburban white kid listens to way too much Juice WRLD? Yeah, that probably is too harsh, but really, I don't think it matters what I say about this song, considering that the actual content has been so thoroughly eclipsed by the uncanny nightmare of a music video which endorses throwing out the medications your doctor prescribes to you. Yeah, the music barely even exists anymore. Look, I'm not gonna shit-talk Dream here. He's clearly going through something, and this song is a means of him trying to work through that, and I genuinely hope he ends up overcoming whatever demons he has, but I'm sorry. Even beyond telling his audience of 10-year-old kids that taking medication is just society trying to kill what makes you unique, this is just not good music. When the central lyric of your song is, "That's what the mask is, that's what the point of the mask is," and it's sung in a tone that makes the kid Roy sound like Barry White. Look, my job isn't to stomp on a guy trying to deal with his baggage, but my job is to call out bad music. And everything about this as a piece of media is poorly made to a comical extent. Juice WRLD's got a massive back catalog sitting right there, and you'd be better off digging into that any day of the week.
Let's get down to business. Give you one more night, one them or not to get this.
I don't know if most people realize just what an absurdly long and fruitful career Tiësto has had as a producer. The dude is 52 years old. He started producing in 1994, and he's had intermittent success on and off pretty much nonstop since then. I would not have expected a guy who debuted the same year as Smash Mouth to have one of the biggest international crossovers of 2020, and yet, here we are. The Business is apparently still one of the best-selling digital sales songs in the US to this day, and honestly, I don't really understand why. I mean, it's a nice little deep house song, but nothing about it really stood out to me one way or another. It's the kind of song that's just sort of there. Despite the high sales, it never really caught on in the American mainstream, which I guess was the mentality behind giving it this follow-up, which literally just replaces the no-namer on vocals with Ty Dolla Sign, and yeah, you can tell this didn't exactly come from a place of passion from either of them. There's some points where you can still hear the remnants of the production based around the original vocalist, which I'm pretty sure was meant to be a cool vocal styling, but it just makes the entire thing seem awkward and kind of malformed. This is the type of song that is better served with vocals from some European nobody instead of Drake Light. So yeah, if you just have to listen to this, the original is the way to go. And we're obviously in the midst of a real pop-punk revival, it's only fitting that some new names within the genre are going to start getting some more attention. And if the genre does end up sticking around, I wouldn't be surprised if we started hearing more about Glass Beach very soon. The stereotype about pop-punk is that it's just a bunch of whiny kids jamming out basic-ass riffs on a guitar, and there's definitely something charming about the purity of that, but an act like Glass Beach, which is, in the words of contemporary reviews, post-emo maximalist, definitely shows that the genre still has a lot more ground left to cover before the mainstream gets the full taste of it. I don't know if I've ever heard an emo pop-punk song that I could reasonably describe as soaring before, but this one certainly fits the mold, and if you're interested in the newly revived scene at all, I'd say based on the merits of this one that Glass Beach are definitely worth a look.
Bloody tracks left right by the drain. Say the name.
Candlesticks in the dark, visions of bodies being burned. Candlesticks in the dark, visions of bodies being burned.
Man, industrial is such a cool genre. It's such a broad, nebulous term with a wide variety of meanings, but you can just slap the word industrial onto just about any genre. You'll end up with some of the most envelope-pushing music you're ever likely to find that really pushes up against the limits of whatever genre you're referring to. And that's definitely the case with Clipping, an experimental industrial hip-hop group from LA. This particular song, Say the Name, is actually one of their more accessible tunes based on the few I've sampled, taking certain horrorcore lyrical conceptions and mixing them in with overwhelming, woofer-destroying bass into really aggressive prog metal instrumental that slowly builds over time, hook after hook, and all coming together to create an incredibly unique musical atmosphere. I've only listened to this a few times, and the words candlesticks in the dark, visions of bodies being burned are already permanently etched into my cerebrum. This is the type of song that's going to appear on a soundtrack to just the right movie and absolutely kill in whatever scene they decide to play it over, mark my words.
I'm so excited, it's yoga time, only men invited. Don't be late or we'll suck your dick.
This is an old school style rap song about a naked yoga class composed entirely of men. It's by a group called the Steedly Steeds, who also have a song called Dear Joe Biden, where they say they voted for Joe because he was the most fuckable candidate and now Joe owes them one back. In the song, the dude clarifies that the entire naked yoga class is no homo, except for on Thursdays, and clarified that this is perhaps the straightest thing that anyone has ever done in the history of anything ever. In the outro, the announcer announces that all of the classes have been canceled except the ones on Thursdays.
Good Lord, I hate every last one of you.
This isn't the first time the number one pick in one of these videos has been from someone who recently passed away, and the segments like this I do are typically pretty low-key and somber, but, yeah, I don't think that's gonna work here.
Baby, can't you see? Stacey's mom has got it going on. She's all I want, and I've waited for so long. Stacey, can't you see? You're just not the girl for me.
Even today, as pop punk is making a glorious return to form as one of the most popular musical genres of the TikTok era, I don't know if the modern day will ever be able to come close to touching that magical golden moment of punk-flavored power pop from the first half of the Bush administration, with quite possibly the greatest example of this being the all-time classic staple of 2000s pop culture, Stacy's Mom, or as my brother's friends apparently call it, Casey's Mom. The masterpiece of noted songwriter Adam Schlesinger, who tragically lost his life to COVID last year, Stacy's Mom absolutely kills right from the opening notes, as those lively guitars keep great pace throughout the verses and slam in with the perfect force on the chorus, all while being accented by an ear-catching electric piano piece in the treble that sticks around all throughout the song. This is often mistaken for a Bare Naked Ladies track, so much so that the Bare Naked Ladies eventually covered it purely so that everyone who attributed the song to them wouldn't technically be wrong anymore, but I've never heard anything from the Bare Naked Ladies that sounds this rich and fleshed out. Then again, a lot of the comparison probably comes down to the song's subject matter, as, yeah, it's about a teenage boy having a horny jerk-off fantasy about the mom of a girl who's interested in him. I can definitely see this topic wigging some people out, especially in conjunction with the video, which, well, let's just say it's a video that only could have been made in the early 2000s, and I mean that in the most collar-tugging way possible. What sells the song for me, though, and I can't believe I'm saying this, is how seriously they're taking it. Like, don't get me wrong, it's a bright, sunshiny, happy, fun song, but at the same time, there's a certain amount of weight to it, bizarrely enough. It genuinely seems like this kid actually thinks he might have a shot with this woman, to the point where he straight up tells Stacy to her face that he's not interested in her. In a way, this song is kind of a perfect illustration of what makes pop music so wonderful, because if you were to present this situation in a book or a movie, it'd be bizarre and really uncomfortable. But when you wrap it up in this bright, summertime pop package, it turns into nothing but innocent fun, with the seriousness of the lyrics not giving weight to a real situation, but rather giving weight to the joy of discovery of a young person's first sexual awakening. Because, let's be real, we've all had crushes on adults when we were kids, whether they were celebrities or just normal people we knew. It's a completely normal and relatable part of growing up, and Fountains of Wayne managed to capture the intensity of that first unattainable crush while still maintaining a knowing smirk at how silly it is with hindsight. Adam Schlesinger was a gifted songwriter who had a real knack for striking this kind of balance, and his death was an absolute tragedy. He didn't get his one big hit until he was in his 30s, but it was well worth the wait, because Stacy's Mom is a song that it's impossible not to love, no matter how hard you look for reasons to.
I know it might be wrong, but I'm in love with Stacy's Mom.
And with that, we have finally reached the end. If you'd like to take part in the voting and suggestion for the next episode of Grab Bag Reviews, well, now's the time to do it, because surprise, voting for the next episode will be open tomorrow. That's right, for a pledge of just $2 per main series video, you can get access to the voting for episode 7 of Grab Bag Reviews starting immediately tomorrow, Monday the 30th at 2 p.m. Eastern Time. Are there any songs that you really want to hear me talk about, or a song that you think deserves the attention of a wider audience? Well then, there's never been a better time to hop in. You can have a direct say in submitting and voting for what songs I talk about in this series next, as well as having a chance to be picked to give a patron review at the end of each of my rankings and countdown, all for the same price as a cup of coffee a couple times a month. Not a bad deal, if you ask me. Furthermore, for a pledge of $5 per main series video, you get to be a part of the community of awesome people on my Discord server. For $10 per main series video, you get early access to my videos, as well as a personalized icon in the end credits, which will be coming soon. And of course, for $20 per main series video, you get to pick a song for me to do a mini review on, and not just the next episode of Grab Bag Reviews, but in each new episode of Grab Bag Reviews. Thank you all for your continued support. Running this channel wouldn't be possible without you, and every little bit helps more than you can possibly know. I'm Sean Faywolf at Diamond Axe Studios. I'll see you guys next time, and until then, take care.
When I popped off, then your girl gave me just a little bit of la chop. Baby so cold, he from the north, he from the Canada. Bankroll so low.
Oh, and I almost forgot. I also told Pride, one of my Discord admins, that I would review a song for him. This is a guy who's honestly put a ton of work into the server. He's been so incredibly helpful. So, you know what? Just for you, buddy, I'm going to take the song you gave me, and I'm going to give it the best possible review in the world. Here we go. All right, yeah, I think that should do it. Thank you all again for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye!
Candlesticks in the dark, visions of bodies being burned. Candlesticks in the dark, visions of bodies being burned. Candlesticks in the dark, visions of bodies being burned. Candlesticks in the dark, visions of bodies being burned.
The hook gon' be what it is, the hands off. The retribution for what you took from the man. Got blood on the rust, God bless the red earth, the dead man walks.